So yours has been a life in research, that's obvious. But I saw in an interview with you that you said the interest in research went back to your childhood. So I'm going to go back to your childhood and describe the context, the family, the young boy. Who were you? What was the intellectual atmosphere in your home?
Well, I was born in Heraklion, in Crete, in 1946. And my family was a family of merchants. The origin of my grandfather was from Turkey, from my mother was born in Smyrna. Okay. And I have a very happy childhood. My father was of Cretan origin and my mother was from Smyrna, from Turkey. All my memories of my childhood are very, very happy. I had a lot of love from my parents, my grandparents, the family.
A lot of books too?
Not so many books. And I would like to say that I was looking for books when I was a young boy. And also by nature, I was very curious. So a lot of curiosity, and this was sometimes very embarrassing for my parents. So I was keeping asking questions about how the radio works, how I don't have television at that time, how the car works. And I was insisting on that. So I remember sometime we were walking with my father downtown, and I asked him how the electric bulb works. And my father gave an explanation. I was not happy with that. And so later on, we encounter a friend of him, and I asked him, hello, you see my father, I asked about the electric bulb, and he told me the story, I don't believe it. So do you have any better explanation?
You said this?
Yes, yes.
You were and old.
Five years old, not more, yes. So I had this obstination, trying to understand in depth everything, and still I have this obstination. And
perfect.
This is...
So is there a school that is going to support you in your curiosity, or will this take a long time to find?
Well, I was independent in the school. I was a very good student, but I did not want to be the first for some reason. Because I had some kind of modesty, and I did not like the spirit of competition. I don't like competition. Okay, I was a very good student, and then I went to Athens to study electrical engineering at the Technical University of Athens, I was a good student, but nothing more.
Okay. I graduated
in 69, so I had regularly 5 years of studies. I got my electrical engineering degree, but...
I want a feeling, if you would agree, to the spirit of what student life was like at such a place.
It was very, very different from student life today, I can imagine. Because it was, it was the 60s, okay, end of the 60s, and at that time students had a very relaxed life, although we had very serious duties. Technical University of Athens was the best school in Greece, so the best students were there. We had to study very hard. But at the same time, we had a lot of interests. Most of us were very strongly involved in politics at that time. And we had plenty of interests. I was passionate about poetry, for instance. I spent many years reading poets and writing poems at that time.
Tempted by a career in poetry, or this was always a secondary interest? Were you interested maybe in being a professional poet?
I was writing poems, but I was reading also a lot of poetry, Greek and foreign poetry. And we had a lot of discussions about, okay, the, you know, all the big questions, philosophical questions, political questions at that time, And so we had a very relaxed and very enjoyable life. Until the moment, and I should talk perhaps about that, we had a dictatorship, this putsch that happened in April 67. And this dramatically has changed our life.
Where were you in your education at that point?
At that point, I was in the middle of my education, so I finished, I graduated in July 69. And then I wanted to leave the country because I was an active opponent to the regime at that time and involved in some.
It was a political, not a career decision to leave.
Well, it was mixed, I would say. I wanted to continue my studies because I did not want to get involved in professional life, so to continue as a researcher, this was my dream from the beginning. And of course, the political situation okay, stimulated me, and I tried to leave the country, and I needed a passport, and this was not easy to obtain at that time, so I had to wait for 1 year, and finally I got a permission to leave the country for only a few months, and I went to Europe, and by some chance I arrived in Grenoble, France, and I stayed there.
By chance?
By some chance, yes. Ah. Okay, because I wanted to study physics and I had a visa for only a few European countries and a tourist visa at that time. Okay, so I went to Grenoble and then I got stuck because as an opponent to the regime, I did not have also my passport renewed and I stayed there for 4 years without passport.
Why was, again, the professional part of your life, why was physics going to be your
choice? Physics, because I loved physics, I loved mathematics, and I wanted to study theoretical physics. So when I arrived in Grenoble, I applied and was admitted for a master in theoretical physics. And okay, now I should talk about the encounter with informatics and computer science.
Yes, indeed. Which you hadn't really thought about before.
No, absolutely not. Because at that time, even the term informatics existed in French, was informatique. Mm-hmm. So I had my first encounter, in fact, with a computer. I had to write some programs. And I got very much interested in the underlying mathematics. I met a professor who was a very visionary guy, Professor Jean Kunzmann, who had created the Institute for Applied Mathematics and Informatics. And okay, so he influenced a lot my career because I was convinced to change, and I got enrolled as a bachelor student in computer science.
I'm going to ask an odd question. What did he see in you? Did he ever say? I mean, did he pick you out?
I became a PhD student. I was the last PhD student of him.
Really?
Yes, because he was retiring. He was at the point of retiring. Okay, we had very, very interesting discussions because I was passionate about the systems theory and he liked systems theory. So he gave me a first topic to study when I was a student already, and I progressed a lot, so he liked my work. I would like to say that I moved very fast in my career. I published very, very fast.
What age?
A thesis. So I was, when I arrived in France, I was in the age of 22.
Yes.
And then I passed my first thesis in the age of, 70. I was 22. And I passed my first thesis, engineering thesis, in the age of 24.
In a way, we're doing a history of your curiosity. So at this point, what are you curious about? What are you beginning to wonder about as a kind of topic to involve?
Yes, so what I found really amazing with the computers is that they can perform calculations very quickly, very precisely, and they can be instructed to solve problems. So since my childhood, I was very passionate with problem solving, okay? Not so much theory, of course, understanding the theory, but being able to solve problems. And I liked in particular Euclidean geometry. I was passionate about that, just solving problems. So this is what I liked in computer science, the ability to program computers, specify the solution of problems and program it and have the computers calculate the solution for you.
I'm aware of your mentor, but is there a young community of people interested in informatics that you are seeing in Grenoble, or are you pretty much alone in your
No, there has been a quite large community of researchers, and I started in a team where we studied hardware, and then I was much more interested in software and the theory for building software, so I moved to another team and I got interested in theories for building software, and finally theories about how to verify software, and this led me to the development of the theory that for model checking, for which I got the Turing Award.
You are much celebrated.
Yes.
What was your doctoral topic?
So my doctoral topic was about verification, was about verification, and I have taken an approach that when I passed. So this was the topic for my, it was a thesis that is equivalent of a diploma of habilitation, who understand what it means. And when I passed my thesis, I had already all the theory for model checking. It was in 79. And at that time, the jury criticized my work because they were saying that this is too complex to be implemented, that this is not realistic enough.
Really?
Because I have taken an approach that I was seeking fully automation of verification of programs, and you know, there are some theoretical limitations that say that the verification process cannot be automated by using computers. So I have simplified the problem by assuming that I have only a finite number of states, but very large number of states. So the criticism was that computers have a very large number of states, so this will never be applicable. And so the theory has remained on paper until we had sufficiently powerful computers that have overcome all these complexity problems and the first real application.
So you anticipated?
We have anticipated. So this model checking is an idea that we have developed in parallel with other people in the US. Yes.
You know, it's quite amazing, I think, for those who grew up intellectually with the computer revolution, mm-hmm. that it's one of those moments where the young know more than their teachers.
You are not constrained by ideas that you have all the past.
Okay? Exactly.
You are young. You see the world in a very different manner, and you are innocent also, and you dare doing things that others do not dare. Yes.
Would you say that?
So it's a kind of innocence, or
okay. It was innocence. Was there a little arrogance?
It's an innocence, and I am arrogant. Okay, I'm arrogant, not really, because I'm a modest guy, but. When I believe, I have the intimate conviction that my ideas are right, then I pursue them, no matter how much it costs.
In your professional career, so you've chosen your interest, you've gotten your PhD, you fought those who were saying, no, it's not the right path. How do you manage to get a position in Grenoble? Who is seeing that?
At that time, it was very easy to get a position. Because I mean, life, you did not have all the problems with unemployment you have today, okay? So I got, I have a good record, I have good publication, so I got a position of researcher in 74 already. And I like this job of a researcher because you have a lot of freedom, okay? In France, the system used to be very liberal. You have to produce a report per year saying I have published so many papers, and it's very lightweight. So you are free. Of course, the problem is to be able to manage this freedom, okay? That's the problem, okay? Because you can be lost, okay, if you don't... if you don't know which way to go, you can be lost. Okay.
But you were not. Not too
I
much.
Think I was lost for some time, or I have taken some non-beaten paths, say.
Okay.
And I was lucky because these finally have proven to be very good choices. But from the beginning, I mean, it was not obvious that I had made a good choice.
Here's a young man, launched, the right mind for the right moment. How are you thinking about the future of this field at this point? Because we will come to what you now think of it. But as a young man, late 20s, launched, what was the future you thought of this choice?
You're talking about the future of my choice or the future of the field?
In a way, both.
Both. So for my choice, I was quite confident that this was not a bad choice. Okay. And so I persisted in that direction, and I should say that we had problems with publishing initially.
Okay.
Because the ideas were not admitted until the moment we decided to create our own community and our own conferences, because we were excluded from all other conferences. That's funny to say it now. We created our own conference that is now a big conference, a huge community around it. It's called Computer-Aided Verification. Now, regarding the question, what was our vision about computer science at that time?
Sorry.
Computer science at that time was not perceived as we perceive it today. It was much more focused, and also we wrongly believed at that time that we could develop theories that were close to the theories we have in physics, we had a very positivistic view of computing, okay, which turned out to be not the right view, and of course this is a matter of discussion. Still, people do not agree about the focus, about the perimeter, about what computing is. There is a lot of debate even today. But at that time, we thought, I have actively worked at that. We thought that we could develop theories for programs, for software, that would allow us to build software as we build bridges, for instance, to have predictability, as we say. So you know that when you build bridges, you write down equations, you rely on a very robust theory that is, classical physics. And this allows you to guarantee that a bridge will not collapse with very high probability for centuries, say. Okay, for software we don't have, and probably we will not have, this kind of theory. Mm-hmm. I don't want to be too technical, but if we have theory and predictability, we'll have a different kind of theory.
And back to your career, because soon, I think, you begin to develop a center that where you can pursue some of these important ideas. I'm very interested in the France of your circumstance, because we spend so much time imagining what's happening in California and you know, these other significant centers of computer thinking. Are you feeling isolated in France? Or are you feeling, what is your community of intellectuals?
Yes, okay. I in France, I did not feel really as French. I was very open. I had a lot of connections with the US, with other countries, with Germany, Sweden, Israel, a lot. Yeah. Had a very good friend from Israel who also was a professor in the US. So I did not felt too much connected to
in the larger intellectual community.
I was traveling a lot, so I was really connected with a broader community, and I have created a community and was one of the leaders of the community with Americans, other people.
The center, was it in part an idea to bring this conversation to Grenoble?
Yes. So I created this laboratory that is called Verimag, beginning of the 90s. And the idea is to find some industrial partner to apply our ideas. And we found at that time two partners. One was Airbus, that at that time was not even called Airbus, it was a small company called Aerospatial. And they had only a very small portion of the market at that time. And another company was a company that disappeared today, and were building control systems for nuclear plants. So the challenge for me at that time was to apply my theory about how to verify a system to build what people call now safety critical systems. So problem is how to guarantee the safety of an aircraft. And at that time, so you see, I was lucky again. At the time, Airbus, they have designed the A320, which is a very successful aircraft. And A320 is the first fly-by-wire aircraft. So what fly-by-wire means, you have for the first time a computer interpreting the commands of the pilot. So the commands of the pilot, are not translated through some electromechanical system, but they are interpreted by the computer, and the computer gives orders to the electromechanical parts of the aircraft. And this was a great idea that has been first applied by Airbus, but in order to apply this idea, you need to prove that it will work. So you need to convince certification authorities, and our technological results, scientific results, helped Airbus with passing successfully the certification of A320, and this was a big success.
Who in Airbus was intelligent enough to look to your laboratory for solutions?
Well, it's very, very complicated, so I cannot name people here, but they made the decision. They had a small company, a small startup developing software technology for them, and we have collaborated with this company. We had a joint lab, so my lab started as a joint industrial academic lab. We had a contract for 4 years to prepare to develop the technology. And finally, we've been successful at that.
It's almost an ideal model for the cooperation of the commercial world, of the intellectual academic world.
Yes, and at that time, for France, this was quite unusual.
And yet you propose yourself as a modest man. You must have taken a lot of energy, found a lot of energy to make this happen.
Yes, but this was really an exciting task. And I had a very good team, I had to find good researchers, and I was lucky enough. You see, when you have a strong desire for something, a strong willingness for something, then you have a kind of, conspiracy of the universe that helps, somehow.
At this time, are you writing many papers as
well? I was writing papers, but also I like very much practice, okay? So I don't have as many publications as others, okay? But I have done a lot of things in coordinating people, setting up projects, okay, applying my ideas. Okay. This is what I like. I like to be a leader, okay?
Yes, and have been, in fact.
Yes, bit. Yes, I like this.
The again, the state of the present and the future in your field. Let us now, we're now in the late 90s. I just picked this as a time.
Yes.
At this time, this is happening, but also are you beginning to speculate on the possibilities of your world? Are you beginning to feel very positive or perhaps disappointed with where your field is going? In its questions, one of them, of course, would be artificial intelligence, but broadly, how are you thinking about your field in the late?
Okay, I had ups and downs, of course, and I have to say here that I have completely broken with this topic, research topic of verification. And the big surprise of everybody in my community, I said, well, I don't want to work anymore on that.
It's boring even at this point?
It's boring, or I don't expect any new spectacular results. So end of the 90s, I changed.
Okay.
And I selected another topic on which I am working. In fact, I changed two times the topic of my research.
Tell me about
the change. Okay. So one, that I was interested in what people call now embedded systems.
Okay.
So embedded systems are systems that are continuously interacting with an external environment. So from my experience with Airbus, understood that there are serious engineering problems with these systems that control aircraft, trains, cars. And today we have 95% of the computers are embedded, so are not accessible directly to people. They are interacting, they are controlling external environments. So I felt at the time that this could be the next revolution, and I actively worked also to set up a research community in Europe. I was for almost 10 years the scientific director of a network of excellence, a European network of excellence called Artists in Europe. And I started this work in parallel with some colleagues in the US. So we started in parallel research programs that I believe have been very successful on both sides.
Okay. What was the question? There are many, of course. But
so there are many questions. So the question is how to program computers so that they interact with an environment, a physical environment, at the adequate, with the adequate response times, and how to guarantee these response times.
Okay.
So the problem here is a bit different from just simple verification of software programs, because you have to consider the software in interaction with the hardware. And this is a very hard problem, how to understand the interaction between software that executes at a certain time scale and hardware that is more than 100 million times faster than software.
Mm.
So it's and still there are some open problems about how to understand this interaction and how to predict or how the system, the dynamic system, hardware, software will behave.
So this is still very much of an open
question. This is very much still a very much open question, although today we have theories about that, about how to do that. But there are still some open questions. Then I got interested in systems where, okay, you have not a single embedded system, so a single computer interacting with the environment, but many of them.
Mm.
And many of them moving, for instance, like now you have in cars, And the problem I'm studying currently is, in particular, mobile systems. So if you have many computers that are mobile, how they communicate, how they interact, you organize the communication. And these are very hard problems because the environment is changing constantly, and you have not only physical environment, but you have an environment with computers and humans.
What is the payoff, if I might use that phrase, when we get it right, when we can figure out embedded systems in that sense? Where will we have advanced?
Okay, so for single embedded systems, I think now we master the technology and we have very safe aircraft, we have relatively safe cars, but not autonomous, because autonomous cars means, or autonomous aircraft is the second problem, the other problem, okay, that they interact with other computers and with other cars, and you have also the human factor. And take into account the human factor, this is very, very hard, because humans are not as predictable as a natural phenomena, okay? So the challenge today is this, is to reach a vision that some people call the Internet of Things. So what's the Internet of Things? Internet of Things is, you have now a system of systems. So you have embedded systems everywhere. They collect information, they control local environments, and you have a network and infrastructure. You want to collect all these informations and send them, say, to the cloud. The cloud can analyze all this information, create some knowledge, which will allow also some predictability about the whole system, and then send orders to the systems, the embedded systems that are geographically distributed and are providing services at different places for different areas.
So is this a process that universally excites, or does it seem to terrify some people, this next stage?
Oh, okay. Personally, I'm not terrified.
Oh, I know.
Yes,
you are.
Okay, yes. But some people may think that this can be dangerous to do that. I think that, this is a vision, this is a technological vision, and that raises also scientific problems. I don't know today if this vision is reachable at all, okay?
Yes.
And there are some very open questions about that. Now some people may be terrified for different reasons. There are good reasons to be terrified and bad reasons for being terrified. So, some people today are speculating on the fact that systems would become super intelligent, and at some point system intelligence will exceed human intelligence. I don't even understand what it means. I mean, logically, it's nonsense. Okay, so people are scared about that, and people are speculating for various reasons. I don't want to say anything about that. The good reasons one may have to be afraid is that now we will have an increasing automation of systems that will be providing services everywhere, and as automation increases, you will have only a few people, a few agents making the critical decisions, and that's the real danger. And also this dependency on some infrastructure that is not guaranteed to work perfectly. You know that there are a lot of problems with security, for instance. And nobody can guarantee the security of even the best protected system, and we have evidence about that every day. So the best we can do, technically speaking, is that we have watchdogs, we have alarm systems that monitor the behavior of the system, and if there is an intrusion, with, I mean, if the monitors are smart enough, they can discover the intrusion. But you cannot avoid intrusions. This is almost, I mean, this is it's evident. You cannot avoid intrusions. And the reason you cannot avoid intrusion is because all this infrastructure, the internet in particular, has been built in a very empirical manner, no theory, and in a very incremental manner. You see, there is a big difference between the technology we used for Airbus. So for Airbus, there are very strict rules, and this is a closed system, not yet interacting a lot with humans or the pilot. And for this type of systems, at very high costs, we know how to guarantee safety and security. For very general purpose systems, the systems are developed in perhaps not by good engineers, without any theory and without any rigorousness, and we have no guarantees at all. So the situation is very different. If the systems are open, there are plenty of holes in the internet, the operating systems, all the infrastructure. And if you don't understand how a system is built, then you cannot guarantee if that there is no hole. So intrusions are always possible. So just to summarize, a big risk today is we have some accidents under code with the systems, especially if they provide some critical services. And this is a big debate now. You've heard probably of the discussion about having self-driving cars in big cities, okay? All of the stories about Tesla cars or whatever. It may be dangerous to have this because these are open systems for which that cannot be developed in the same manner as safety critical systems we have, say, nuclear plants or in aircraft or some weapon systems.
Finally, I want to ask you about the reputation of your field, because I think you've taken some interest in having the world understanding that computing itself is, I think your phrase is, a domain of knowledge.
It's
not a handmaiden. It's not a secondary field to support.
Yes, that's my point. That's my point. So, first of all, it's clear that computing is not just science, because science is about, science studies physical phenomena. It's about discovering laws, understanding how nature works. So computing has some scientific dimension to the extent you can consider some physical phenomena as computational phenomena. But computing has started from mathematics, so we have mathematical ideas, so this is not a posteriori knowledge, this is a priori knowledge, okay? So you start from mathematics and you have, and this is Turing's idea about what computation and computers are, and then you try to implement this idea by using some elements, physical elements, can be switches of any kind, can be relays initially, electronic tubes, transistors, whatever. So computers are artifacts. And in order to talk about computing, I think the most adequate term is domain of knowledge, because knowledge also is very important for computing, you know this. So what is knowledge? My definition of knowledge is that it is information that either allows you to understand the situation, so in particular this is scientific knowledge, or it allows you to build artifacts or to solve problems. So when you build computers, or you are an engineer, you build artifacts, okay? So knowledge is a kind of combination between scientific knowledge and design knowledge or engineering knowledge.
Okay? Is it a stage beyond information, or is information and knowledge equivalent?
Okay, phrases? So no, you have information that is not knowledge, okay? So information is more general concept. Information is, okay, I don't want to get too theoretical because there is a theoretical definition of information, but information is a structure that you can interpret, okay? And it's a relationship between a mind and a structure, in fact. Okay. Now, knowledge is information that is useful, you can use and reuse. It's like a packet of information. So, for instance, the Pythagorean theorem is knowledge. Why it's knowledge? Because if I can apply the Pythagorean theorem, it gives a relationship, and I can apply it in many different circumstances to solve problems, okay? Newton's laws are knowledge, okay? So this is knowledge. It's a relationship that you can, it's a scheme, in fact. It's a generic relation that you can apply and apply many times, a packet of information.
What about the phrase the information age? It's a tag, maybe, but
yes. Okay. So let me say in a very simple manner what information is. So information is, what information is with respect to other entities that our mind understands very well because of our education. So everybody understands that we have entities like mass and energy, okay? These are the basic entities in physics, okay? Now, information is not mass, I mean, it's not a physical entity. Information is just a meaning you give to a structure. So, and the meaning, you can encode it with symbols. So if I tell you something, I give you some information, you can put it on a piece of paper, you can write it in some memory, whatever, can stay there forever.
Right.
So a property of information that it is non-physical. So this is a big debate, but this is my point of view. Okay, that it is immaterial. It's right. An entity that's different from matter. Yeah. Why? Because it's not matter and energy are subject to, you have matter and energy are involved in phenomena. To understand them, you need time and space. Information, you don't need time, you don't need space, okay? And this is it's a concept with which we are not familiar. So let me say something. I had a very interesting discussion with children. So I go often to some countries and I give lectures. So someday I was in India. And I was explaining what information is in a school, and a child raises his hand and says, "Sir, does information have weight?" Oh, come on. So, what do you think? It has weight or not? Says, "No, I think it has no weight." And you see, information, if so, in your brain, you have information. Now something happens, or in my brain, I forgot everything about my past. I'm not anymore the same person, but I have all the same physical characteristics, the same weight, exactly, okay? So I like this remark by the young Indian, and this, just to finish, reminds me of another joke. This is a French joke. So the father and the child are eating Gruyere, you know, this cheese with the huge holes. So they're eating Gruyere, And when they finished, the child asks the father, "Dad, where are the holes now?" And the information is the holes, exactly. Okay. Yeah.
Wonderful. Yeah. Last question I'm going to ask the poet. So we have data, we have information, we have knowledge as categories.
Yes.
Does wisdom have a role? Is this?
Yes. The concept of wisdom also can be formalized to some extent. Okay, so let me explain the difference between knowledge and wisdom. So you can have plenty of knowledge. You can know plenty of things. Wisdom is the ability to use the right piece of knowledge, the right moment, okay, to solve problems. And this is wisdom, okay? So it's an order of, it's higher than knowledge. You have knowledge, and then wisdom is the ability to use the knowledge you have acquired.
So perhaps we're not yet in the wisdom age.
I don't know, yes, okay. But I think also that people are not curious enough today, so they have, they don't try to differentiate them, to enrich their knowledge and to have a variety of point of views, okay, to compare them and to think, okay. I find that my generation was much more anxious about what truth is and truthful knowledge is, yes.
Thank you.